then invite as many people as you can, okay? All right, hallelujah. So I want to welcome everyone tuning in on the internet at home. Welcome to the Vineyard. I'm not really sure what the Lord wants to do today with the teaching, so we'll just start somewhere. Father, thank you for, you're the teacher, Lord, so would you teach us today? Show us what to say and where to go in your word. And may your will be done. Amen. Hallelujah. Wow, so much going on. So a friend of mine, his name is Jesse Steins. Man, what's going on? It's a little... Jesse Steins. I'll just pop it out there. Somebody remind me I need to buy a little cover for this, okay? Jesse Steins is a friend of mine, and he passed away, but he had a congregation just like the Vineyard, a spirit-filled congregation that kept the feast days and the Sabbath, and one day he was praying, and he asked the Lord, he was like, Lord, what part of the Mishkan, or the tabernacle, am I? Where am I in the tabernacle, okay? This, don't build a doctrine out of this, I'm just telling you a story, okay? And the Lord showed him that he was actually the menorah, okay? And, you know, the priests had to clean the menorah. The actual real menorah was a seven-branched candlestick that had, like, these little genie, you know, like, a genie comes out. It's a lamp, a little lamp. You know what I mean? All right? And this little lamp sat on top of this stem, and you could take it out, and you would take the lid would come off. It would have a wick in it, and you would put the oil in there, and you would then set it back down, and the wick would saturate the oil, and then you would light that. Okay, and that's how it was lit up in there. Well, that represents our prayer and worship. But guess what? What happens if the wick gets too long? Is it a beautiful smell? Is it a clean burn? Huh? It gets yucky and stinky, and it can actually poison instead of be healthy. So what does that mean? I really, you know, how does that apply to us? Listen, even your prayer life can get stagnant. You've got to trim your wicks. Hear me. You've got to adjust things sometimes in how you pray. You've got to rearrange things. You've got to keep your prayer life lively and active and fresh and new, and you've got to trim your wicks. You can get into a habit of just reading through the prayer list. Oh, bless so-and-so, so-and-so, and then touch so-and-so, and would you touch so-and-so, and then I did that, and you set it to the side. Yes, prayer is actually a duty. It's called a service. The Jewish people don't look at it like we do. Prayer is called the service of the heart. It's an obligation. It's not an option. Prayer's not an option. It's an obligation. But guess what? Don't get stagnant and stale with it. Switch it up and change it, adjust things, keep it fresh, keep it new. And in so doing, you will find a refreshing place in your prayer closet. Okay? Thank you, Lord. So trim the wicks. There's so much in this portion. I think we're gonna talk about three different areas today out of this Torah portion. We're gonna speak prophetically and practically, then we're gonna look at the Sabbath day, and then we're gonna look at the gospel. In this first few verses, we're gonna see the gospel just hidden in here. You know what's interesting? There's this concept throughout the Bible that people cost money. It's really interesting because the whole house of Israel was supposed to be a kingdom of priests. But when the golden calf was built, God singled out a specific group of people, right? But even before that, God chose the firstborn male among every house. And there's even today a ceremony where you have to buy back the firstborn male from the Lord by going to a Kohen or a priest. People cost money. This Torah portion is connected with Purim because we read it right either before or after the holiday called Purim. And if you look in the holiday, if you look in the story of Esther, Haman actually was going to pay for the people. He was going to give King Ahasuerus, or Xerxes, he was going to give him the equivalent of like $10 million. When you look at the amount of silver that he was paying, and there have been people that kind of did the math, and it almost equals to the Torah portion amount of a shekel per head. Isn't that interesting? Because that story happened during a time when God had actually allowed some of the children of Israel to go towards Jerusalem, but a lot of them went the other way, and they began to multiply, and they were very happy in the land. But it's interesting when you think about it that the first thing we read in this portion is about people cost money. The King James says, "When thou takest the sum of the children of Israel after their number, then shall they give every man a ransom for his soul unto the Lord. When thou numberest them, that there be no plague among them, when thou numberest them." The New Living Translation says, "Whenever you take a census of the people of Israel, each man who is counted must pay a ransom for himself to the Lord. Then no plague will strike the people as you count them." This is interesting. My wife brought this up. We were talking. You remember David counted the people? Did he collect any money? It's interesting. A plague broke out. "When you take a census of the children of Israel to number them, every man that you count shall give a ransom for his soul to the Lord Yahweh. Then no plague will be among them when you count them." Kitisa et Rosh B'nai Israel. That's what that says. Ki tisa, say that. Ki tisa. This Torah portion, we have the sin that caused Moses to have to fast for 80 more days. He goes up the mountain, he's there 40 days, he's fasting, right? 40 days, 40 nights, no food, no water. He's hanging out with the Lord. Then the people, they kind of freak out because he's gone, right? And they had just come out of a place where there was idols everywhere, and they saw the invisible God do amazing things. Well, then the next thing you know, Moses is gone, so they're like, "Listen, make us some gods." And Pastor Tom and I were studying this text. We were really digging into it, and we came up with an interesting conclusion based on what it says in the Hebrew. It was almost like the children of Israel surrounded Aaron and were threatening him and attacking him and forcing him to do this. He did it, and he submitted to what they wanted. But the Hebrew lays it out like a very good option, like he was kind of like they were threatening him. That's what the Hebrew wording says. But they built the idol, and they lifted up the idol, right? They lifted it up. So I want to say this right at the top. What have you lifted up in the last 2 weeks? This will determine how your next several weeks are going to play out, and this will actually determine how it's going to flow for you in the spring feasts. Have you lifted up old things that you shouldn't be, Or is God taking you to a new place and you're lifting up a new areas, new things in your life? Are you making new choices? See, God has brought you to a crossroads at this season, right before the month of Nisan, right before the spring feast. He brings us to crossroads and he says this to us, choose life. This Torah portion is about lifting things up, and we're all going to be making choices to lift up things and elevate things in our life. I encourage you, choose life. I encourage you, choose a new path. I encourage you to reach out and grab the Lord and grab your destiny in this season. Don't fail the test of going backwards and grabbing and picking things up that you shouldn't be in this season, because that's the test that's presented in this season. What will you pick up? Something old or something new? In Exodus 31, we have some, scriptures about the Sabbath. How many of you love the Sabbath? Yeah. I mean, it's a delight. Do you delight in the Sabbath? Isn't it the best day of the week? I mean, the whole week points to the Sabbath. When we say bye to Sabbath on Saturday night, we gather around the table at my house and we say bye to the Sabbath, and like Monday comes, Sunday morning comes, and I'm already thinking about Sabbath. Honestly, like, I miss you already. Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep. For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. You shall keep the Sabbath therefore, for it is holy unto you. Every one that defile it shall surely be put to death. Whosoever doth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people. What's interesting is this. The phrase here in the Hebrew says, dying you will die. It's very, very similar to what it says in Genesis, if you eat off of the wrong tree, dying you will die. It's got the word death in there twice. But the rabbis teach in this generation, we don't instantly die and we're not stoning people. So what is dying you will die? If you defile the Sabbath by working on that day and doing stuff you shouldn't, you don't die, but you die. Things around you will fall apart. You can lose money. You can lose favor. It's a different kind of death, but that is a reality that is still in effect today. So, thank the Lord we're in a season, in a time of grace. The Sabbath makes us holy. Everybody hear this? Maybe a month or two ago during the fast, I was teaching you that food literally makes you holy. It sets you apart. And if you eat unclean, it actually contaminates the soul realm. It's the exact opposite for the Sabbath. When you keep the Sabbath, it is something that actually blesses the soul realm and makes you a holy, set-apart people. The Sabbath is a sign between us and God that we are His people. And it is to be kept throughout all of the generations. Six work is to be done. I know I'm speaking this to you, but I've learned something new here that I'm going to show you in just a second about the Sabbath. 6 days work should be done, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of rest. It's holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work on the Sabbath day will surely be put to death. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Okay? This is the Veshamru. This is a really catchy tune. Raise your hand if you do know it. Two of you. All right, help me out. Veshamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-shabbat lasot et ha-shabbat ledoratam barit olam. Veshamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-shabbat lasot et ha-shabbat ledoratam barit olam. One more time. Veshamru b'nei Yisrael et ha-shabbat lasot et ha-shabbat ledoratam barit olam. Okay, we're going to do some liturgy one of these Sabbaths. I'm going to throw this in. I'm going to actually transliterate it for you. But this says, Veshamru, and you shall guard, B'nai Israel, the children of Israel, et ha-shabbat, the Sabbath. Now what's interesting is, this is et ha-shabbat. It's got the Aleph Tav in front of it. This is the phrase right here that we're going to get to. B'nai Uvain, B'nai Israel, B'nai Israel. This part right here is really interesting because it says, between you and I, between you and I, it will be a sign between you and I. But the rabbis teach that this B'nai Uvain is connected to this very last word, which is, in the English, you will be refreshed. In the Hebrew, it's vaynafash. Say that. Vaynafash. Okay? So it says, the children of Israel, it is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever, for in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth, and on the seventh day, he rested and he was refreshed, okay? Now it's interesting, this word was refreshed right here is really how the Sabbath day makes you holy, because here's what the rabbis teach. God gives you a special blessing in the soul realm. He breathes on those that keep the Sabbath, and he encourages them and he blesses them on this day. It's called a double portion. The rabbis teach that on the Sabbath, your soul gets a blessing from the Lord, and between you and him, he takes another portion of his spirit and he dumps it into your nefesh. This word vaynafash is the word breathe, but it's the same word that nefesh comes from. The nefesh means you're a breathing creature. But on the Sabbath, God promises to breathe on you and bless you and encourage you in a very special way, other than any other days of the week. It's a special day to receive blessings from the Lord. It's basically a boost in your system. I want you to understand this. On the Sabbath, it's not just a day that we worship. God literally gives an extra portion of his spirit and he boosts it into you on the Sabbath. And guess what Yeshua did on the Sabbath? He healed people on the Sabbath. Why did he heal people on the Sabbath? The believing rabbis teach that Yeshua was teaching us a lesson to take the extra portion of the nefesh, of the soul realm that God boosts you with, and pass it on to others. Yeshua, in the Gospels, is recorded as healing 7 people on the Sabbath. Interesting, 7, specifically 7, no more, no less. He heals 7 different people on the Sabbath. And then if you go study the things that he healed, it carries the whole realm of mind, body, soul, emotions, and all that. So what we're supposed to do is this. Yes, we need to come here, but we do need to remember this. It's a very special day for the miraculous realm. It really is. And our time here is short, and we're going to go and we're going to pray for some miracles a little bit later at somebody's house. Amen. And praise the Lord. Thank you, Father, that we know that you're boosting us to go and pray for others. The Sabbath is called Et HaShabbat. See that? Et HaShabbat. It's called the Sabbath. And the writing of the rabbis tells us this. Anytime that there's this word, and we've been learning about this for like a month. How many of you have been here the last month? We've learned that the Aleph Tav, these two letters, is a secret code to show us Yeshua in the text, right? We learned that the rabbis were writing in several places in the tradition of the rabbis that it was the Aleph Tav that was on the mountain that was actually a mirror that gave the commands to God. And when Moses was standing there in this cloud of glory, he was looking at a mirror, which is the Word of God, which is the Aleph Tav, which is the Shekinah. And he saw himself, but he saw what he was supposed to look like. But when this is present before a word, it means there's something else going on, something supernatural. And Shimon Bar Yochai says that it's the Shekinah, it's the presence of the Lord. This says, L'Toratam, Barit Olam. It means throughout your generations, it is a covenant forever. Okay? Now, what's interesting is last week we learned that this month Adar, is connected to a word Adir, which is strong, but it's also connected to a word Dur, which means generations. So this month is a specific month of families and of generations, and it's a specific month. This next part is really interesting. This is a specific month. We have two more weeks. This is a month where God is in the process of drawing those that aren't following the Shabbat and the feast days into the fold. Amen. That's what he's doing. So I want to encourage you, whoever you're talking to, up it a little bit this month, because God is actually drawing people into the family of Sabbath-keeping congregations. That's what he's doing, okay? It's L'Doratam Barit Olam. It's a covenant throughout the generations. Adar is the month of the fish. Say fish. Okay, why is that important? Because in Genesis 48:16, Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, was blessing Ephraim and Manasseh, and here's what he says. The angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads and let my name be on them, and let the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac be on them. And then he says this, let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. So this is the month of the fish. Check this out. This is a month where God is pulling people from the nations to come into the Sabbath and the feast. Because in the Hebrew, this phrase right here about Ephraim and Manasseh has the word fish in it. It says, Vayadgu larov, which means let Ephraim and Manasseh grow and multiply like fish. And because this is the month of the fish, I want to encourage you, get out and invite people to this congregation that aren't coming. Take advantage of the season we're in, where God is drawing people into the Shabbat throughout all generations. Okay? Proverbs says, I love them that love me and those that seek me early, which means search for me diligently, in the morning shall find me. So we must diligently seek him, we must pray, we must press into him, we must open up the Bible, and we must saturate ourselves with God's word. I love this passage. After the resurrection, when Yeshua is on the road to Emmaus, I use it all the time, because what does it say? Yeshua, beginning at Moses and all the prophets, expounded to them all the things in the scripture about himself. Okay? So what we're going to do today is we're going to take the first part of this Torah portion, Ki Tisa, And I'm going to tear it apart and break it into three sections, and we're going to see the gospel in there, okay? So first I want to just show you something really interesting. Yeshua is a rabbi, right? Now, Judas, who was betraying him, said, Rabbi, it is I. In Matthew 26, immediately he went up to Yeshua and said, Greetings, Rabbi. Peter answered and said to Yeshua in Mark, Rabbi. So all through the Gospels, Yeshua is called Rabbi. So you understand that Yeshua is a rabbi. He's not a pastor. He's a rabbi. What does that mean? I just learned this. Yeshua is the first man in recorded history to be called rabbi. I didn't know that. This is Dr. Michael Brown, his book called The Real Kosher Jesus. He wrote this book because there was an Orthodox rabbi named Shmuley Boteach. Have you heard of Shmuley Boteach? Shmuley Boteach has debates with... Check out their debates. It's amazing. Shmuley Boteach, an Orthodox rabbi, debates Dr. Michael Brown on Yeshua really being the Messiah. And after years of study, this Orthodox rabbi came to the conclusion that the Jesus, the real Jesus, wasn't really the Jesus of Christianity. The real Jesus was kosher. The real Jesus never meant to change the Torah. The real Jesus never gave permission to eat pork. The real Jesus didn't change. This is an Orthodox rabbi, and he wrote a book called The Kosher Jesus. And he got, like, railed. He doesn't believe Yeshua is the Messiah, but he knows that the real Jesus has been misrepresented by Christianity. It's interesting. But he doesn't say he's the Messiah, so Michael Brown wrote The Real Kosher Jesus. And he talks about a lot of the stuff. Talks about a lot of the same stuff, but he says, listen, he's the Messiah. Okay? But on page 7, Michael Brown makes an amazing statement. Jesus wasn't only a Jew himself, he was the first man in recorded history to be called rabbi. I didn't know that. Raise your hand if you knew that. So I read this and I thought, I'm going to have to research it. So I started looking into it. And this is what I found. According to the Mishnah, the sages of the first century, when was Yeshua alive? First century. Never used this title at all, rabbi. The sages simply, sage means an elevated teacher. So the highest teachers in Judaism in the first century never used the term rabbi. They just used their name. One of the greatest rabbinical scholars of the 10th century, Rav She'er Gaon of Babylonia, writes that the title rabbi was not used before the destruction of the Second Temple in 70. Interesting. The designation rabbi came into use with those who were ordained then after the temple's destruction. So they're not admitting that Yeshua was using that term, but what they're doing is they're telling us that that term wasn't used by men as a title until after 70. What's interesting is people were calling Yeshua rabbi before any other person was ever called rabbi. Now think about this in conjunction with that. Call no man rabbi. That's what he says. Nobody's supposed to have that title but him. Actually, that's not what he says. Thank you, Lord. He says, let no one call you rabbi. He doesn't say you can't use the title. He says, let no one call you rabbi. The weight of responsibility is actually put on the other people. But we're not supposed to use that title lightly. Well, This is from Chabad's website. This title was not used. It was not until the second century that rabbi, which literally means my teacher, came into a became an official title. So, this is how you write rabbi in Hebrew. Resh Beit Yod. Rabbi. Resh Beit Yod. So what is a rabbi? A rabbi is a teacher, but a rabbi is also a great one. It means my master or my teacher. And it comes from the word rav. The root word of rabbi is written like this. Rav. Say rav. Okay. Now this is interesting. It says, the very first part of this Torah portion says, when you take the census of the children of Israel, it says this, Ki tisa et rosh b'nei Israel. What it literally says in Hebrew is, when you lift up the head, singular, children of Israel. So it's translated when you take a census of the children of Israel, but that's not even really close to what it says, because what it really is saying is when you lift up and count the head of the children of Israel. So we get this loose translation when you number the children of Israel. When you lift something up, you're counting it, okay? But there's a very interesting phrase in here. Rosh B'nai Israel. Say that. And you have the first letter of each of these words actually spell out the word rabbi. You see this? Rosh B'nai Israel. Go right here and spell out the word rabbi. Does everybody see that? So, the very first thing we need to know is, when you're counting the children of Israel, it should say when you count the heads, plural. Because the way that people were counted in the Jewish mindset wasn't by bodies, it was by skulls. A skull represented a person. Okay? That's a different teaching. It's really interesting. So you counted the heads, right? But it doesn't say heads, it say count the head, the main head. But not only the main head, there's a deeper meaning. This whole first part of the scripture is about atonement for the children of Israel, and they had to pay a certain amount of money to get atonement. But who ultimately paid for our atonement? Yeshua, and he's called the rabbi. So what this text says right off the bat in the Hebrew, it says this, when you lift up the rabbi. Okay? Do you see that? Ki tisa is when you lift up. This word tisa means to lift up or elevate. Then we have the Aleph Tav, which is a picture of Yeshua, and then we have this word, Rosh B'nai Israel, and you take the first letter of each of those words and it spells rabbi. Now this is coming from Jewish men that don't believe in Messiah, but they say it's a messianic picture of one day there's going to be a great rabbi that's going to come, Mashiach ben Yosef, the one that's going to suffer and die for the sins of the people, and he's going to atone once and for all. And he's called the Rosh B'nai Israel, the one that's the rabbi over all the people. Isn't that interesting? So like for the last several weeks, we've been talking about the Aleph Tav, and Shimon Bar Yochai teaches that these two letters, when it's in the text, represents the Shekinah, which is a mirror, which is the Word of God. Amen? When you look into the perfect Word of God, you see what you're supposed to be, how you're supposed to adjust yourself. So this is interesting, and this is written by Daniel Boyren. I keep referring to him. But he was quoted in something that I read recently, and he said this, the main doctrinal difference that separated Christianity from Judaism in the first century, because remember, I've told you over and over and over that they were one sect. It wasn't until the second and third century that Judaism and Christianity separated. And here's what separated them, the teaching on who was the Word of God. Because they were reading in Hebrew and in Aramaic, and the Aramaic translations of the Torah continually had this being right beside the Lord, called the Word of the Lord, who had anthropomorphic connotation and who was personified as being the same as God but separate from God. So they were seeing, and they wrote in their writings that there were two powers, a father and a son, and this was a teaching in the first century. But those who later became Christianity saw this one, the Word of God, as the Messiah, and those who became Orthodox Judaism began to look at, no, this is just a really bad translation of the text, so they separated. So it helps us understand why John writes, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word became flesh. Okay? Yeshua says this in the book of Revelation, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Now, he says this three times in the book of Revelation. He says that I'm the Alpha and Omega, right? You've heard that. Oh, yeah. These are the first and last letters of the Greek alphabet, but here's the question. Did Yeshua speak Greek or Hebrew? He spoke Hebrew. So what would Yeshua have said? Yeshua would have said, I'm the Aleph and the Tav. Why is it important in the first century that Yeshua comes on the scene and he says, I am the Aleph and the Tav? Because all through the Old Testament and all through the writings from Shimon Bar Yochai called the Zohar, the Aleph Tav is represented as divine, as the presence of the Lord, as the one that goes with the children of Israel, as the one that's speaking. There were writings many, many places that personified this, led this word, the Aleph Tav. Okay? This isn't some new thing with Hebrew roots or the Messianic movement. This is actually 2,000 years old. It came from Rabbi Akiva, and Rabbi Akiva was the one that trained the guy that wrote the Zohar, Shimon Bar Yochai. So it's really important that Yeshua comes on scene. He says, I'm the Aleph and the Tav. That's me. All those places hidden in the Bible is me. And Sharon has a Bible that's got all kinds of stuff in it with that. He also says this. This is very, very important. Okay? He says, I'm the Aleph and the Tav, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. What is it? Why is he saying he's the beginning and the end and the first and the last? This isn't just a random statement. I'm the beginning and the end, the first and the last. This is what Isaiah says. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Yeshua, when he says I'm the first and the last, he's actually telling the people, the one that Isaiah was speaking of, that's me. I'm the first and the last. So he's re-quoting something that Isaiah had already said. Why is he saying that? Because Yeshua is the Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, that is speaking. I want you to listen to the wording here. Listen to how this is written. Thus says the Lord. Who's speaking? The Lord, the King of Israel. So the Lord, the King of Israel, is speaking. And his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. How many lords right there are there? Two. And he says, I'm the first and the last. Does it make sense? When it says, I'm the first and the last, the Hebrew word first is rishon. Say rishon. Okay? The word rishon, first, the root word is rosh. Say rosh. The word rosh takes you all the way back to Ki Tisa Rosh B'nai Yisrael. Let's look here. I'm the first and the last. See this word? When you lift up the Rosh, the head, the chief, the leader. So when Yeshua says, I'm the first and the last, when he says the word first, it's the word Rishon, which comes from the root word rosh, which takes you all the way back to this place right here. So this whole text, this very first sentence, Ki Tisa Rosh B'nai Israel, when you lift up the heads of the children of Israel, is about Yeshua being lifted up on a cross and dying for the sins of mankind. Isn't that interesting? The word Rosh means chief, leader, exalted one. And this is it in the pictograph. This is a man. This is a strong leader. And this is two front teeth or a crown. Say a crown. Okay? So when you put the crown on the head, you see a man that's a king or a prince. Chief, king, leader, prince. Okay? When you take a census of the children of Israel, is the word Rosh. So in the scripture, when people were counted, they're counted by skulls. They would get a head count. That's where we get that from. Get a head count. Goes all the way back to the Torah when they would count the heads of the children of Israel. And again, Rosh is singular. It's meaning the only one that has to be counted. Family, hear this. This is how deep the Torah is. Count all the people. Have them give a half shekel. That half shekel will be a ransom and an atonement for their souls. But in the very first part of that, it's not even about that at all. It's about one man will be lifted up on a cross. He's the one called the rabbi. He's the chief leader. And he's the one that makes atonement for everybody else. All in that one sentence. This is it. Ki tisa. Say that. When you take. Say when you take. But really what it means is lift up. It means lift up the head. Why? Because ki tisa means to lift up. Et Rosh means the head, the main leader, the chief. And then you have this right here, which spells out the word rabbi. When you lift up the rabbi, which is very fascinating. When you take a census of the children of Israel to number them, every man that you count shall give a ransom for his soul to the Lord Yahweh. That way no plague will be among them when you count them. This word actually, this is it in English. But in the Hebrew, it's only six words. When you translate it to English, you get a whole paragraph, okay? The black are the actual Hebrew words. But we're going to break it down and tell you what it really says. To number them, every man that you count will give a ransom for his soul to the Lord. The first word means to strike, hurt, or appoint. The second word means to give or receive a gift. The third word, ish, is man. Kofar is the word atonement. Yom Kippur, this is these words right here. Kofar and Kippur is the same words. Nefsho is life or soul. And then it says LeYahweh, to Yahweh. So this passage here says, strike, hurt, appoint, give or receive a gift, a man, a covering or an atonement, life for your soul to Yahweh. When you take a census of the children of Israel to number them, every man that you count shall give a ransom for his soul to the Lord. But in the literal Hebrew, it says this, when you lift up the chief leader, the rabbi, striking, hurting, and appointing him, you receive a gift, atonement for each man's soul to the Lord Yahweh. Isn't that cool? Yeah. So you can take the phrase and you can translate it into 15 words from six, or you can take the phrase and you can look at the deep level of it and say that in this two sentences in this Torah portion, we've seen Yeshua, the chief leader, the rabbi, lifted up, paying atonement, being stricken, smitten, bruised, pierced, paying atonement for you to Yahweh. Isn't that amazing? Listen, I can't wait to sit down with Yeshua and have him teach us all this kind of stuff. You know what I mean? The Torah is absolutely filled, packed full of this kind of stuff. All through it. We just don't know how to decipher it. And when we get little glimpses like this, that's why the rabbis teach every word and every sentence has 70 faces. 70 different ways that you can interpret it. There's no language like Hebrew. Third part. When you take a census of the children of Israel, I'm almost finished. I'm going to wrap it up with this. When you take a census of the children of Israel to number them, every man that you count shall give a ransom for his soul to the Lord Yahweh, that there will be no plague among them when you count them. Okay, again, there's just a few words in here, but we're going to break it down. In counting and appointing, so this is it in the English. When you number them, that there be no plague among them when you number them. That's what it says, okay? But the Hebrew says, in counting and appointing, and then it has this word here. Say, Otam. Otam is the Aleph Tav, which we've seen is Yeshua, the Shekinah, it's the presence of God. So, but it's the Aleph Tav, and then it has an extra letter called the Mem. Say Mem. Do you see it? It's written like this. Right? This is the Mem. This word Mem can mean water or blood. Say water or blood. So it's the Aleph Tav plus water or blood. Okay? So in counting and appointing, the Aleph Tav plus blood, no, velo, to exist, yehia, to look towards judgment, then it has the word plague, and then it has the word counting and appointing again, and then it has the Aleph Tav plus the blood. Okay? So I'm going to, this is, again, not authorized by anybody but me, okay? I'm just translating it literally for you to see Yeshua. In counting and appointing the Aleph Tav Mem, which is Yeshua's blood. See how we got it's Yeshua's blood? There will be no looking towards judgment. The plague is counted and appointed in Aleph Tav Mem, which is Yeshua's blood. Isn't that interesting? So, Ki Tisa Rosh B'nai Israel, when you lift up the head, the chief, the rabbi, the main one, the leader, he will make atonement through his blood, and the plague won't be counted towards you. It will be counted because of his blood that was shed for you. Isn't that interesting? So we see the gospel three times in this one section of scripture. And here it is, totally broken down. So this is what it says in English. When you take us the sum of the children of Israel after their number, then they shall give every man a ransom for his soul to the Lord Yahweh. When you number them, that there be no plague among them, when you number them. So literally, it literally is this. Every person, every man had to get counted. They had to bring a half shekel. When they gave the half shekel, it protected them from a plague. In the future, if there was a census and there wasn't a half shekel, there was a plague. I don't understand it, but that's how God works. But they counted them, they gave the shekel, there was no plague. So that's literally, that literally happened, that's the literal definition. But embedded in that is the gospel. When you lift up the chief leader, Yeshua the rabbi, striking, hurting, and appointing him, you receive a gift, atonement for each man's soul to Yahweh. In counting and appointing the blood of Yeshua, there will be no looking towards judgment. The plague is counted and appointed in the blood of Yeshua. Amazing. Hallelujah. This Torah portion is called to lift up. Isaiah 53. Remember, be careful what you lift up. But here's what Isaiah 53 says. Surely he hath what? Ki tisa. He lifted up. It's the same two words that starts this Torah portion. Isn't that cool? So when he bore, it wasn't about anything other than that's when he gets lifted up on the cross. Surely he's born, he's lifted up. Ki tisa, our griefs. Isn't that what we just read? Striking, hurting, and appointed him, you get a gift. He has borne, ki tisa. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he what? ki tisa, the sins of many. Isn't that what the text said? Because of him, a ransom is given for every single person. And what does Yeshua say? Then Yeshua, Jesus, said to them, when ye have, what language would he have spoken? He would have said, ki tisa, connecting Isaiah in two places and this week's Torah portion about the ransom money that was paid. And then in John later, he says, and if I be ki tisa, lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men to me. Isn't that interesting? So Moses, Isaiah, John, and Yeshua all use this same phrase, ki tisa, to refer to Yeshua being lifted up and dying for our sins. Isn't that cool? And then it says, when you take a census and you number them, every man that you count will give a ransom for his soul. They were to give one set fee. I want you to understand this. Yeshua died once for all. There wasn't like our tax system today. It was separated into, you know, classes. It was one tax, the same tax, and it wasn't even one shekel. It was a half a shekel. The same ransom payment makes atonement and covers all men. What's the plague? Death. So what does that say? Yeshua's one payment covers all men from the plague, which is the curse of sin, which is death. He died once for all. Matthew says, whoever will be chief among you. What is chief? We learned earlier, it's Rosh. Let him be your servant. Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And give himself a what? Give his life a ransom. It's exactly what he did. He gave his life as a ransom. Yeshua is making a direct reference to Exodus 30 by using the word Rosh and using the word ransom. He's teaching this Torah portion. Do you understand that? He was counted and numbered among the sinners. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great. He shall divide the spoil with the strong because he poured out his soul to death and he was numbered. What was this week's Torah portion about? Being numbered. He was numbered in the census with us. But his price was his life. And because he gave his life, he was ki tisa, lifted up on the cross. It gave a ransom for all mankind. Exodus 30:13 says this. This is what they shall give. Everyone that is among those that are numbered, a half shekel, according to the shekel. Say shekel. Shekel. Say shekel. Carry God, he's practicing for Israel. This is the payment. It's called a shekel. Shekel. Now listen, Zechariah says this. And I said to them, if you think good, give me my price. Say my price. And if not, forbear. So they weighed mishkal. Say mishkal. Mishkal is shekel. For my price, 30 pieces of silver. So this, you know, if you don't know, this is what's going on. Zechariah is prophesying about the betrayal of Yeshua. Everybody listen. We're tying it up. Zechariah is prophesying about how much it would cost to buy Yeshua. So how many pieces of silver? 30. And Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priest to betray him unto them. And when they heard it, they were glad and promised to give him shekel, money. And he saw how he may conveniently betray him. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the what? The 30 shekels to the priests and the elders. The Hebrew name of Judas is Judah, say Yehuda. He betrayed the Lord for 30 pieces of silver. The value of his name is 30. Isn't that interesting? His name cost him his life because he betrayed the Son of the Living God. It's it's amazing. Your name is very important, and what you name your children is very, very important. So they weighed for my price 30 pieces of silver. Here's what's interesting. How this is translated. So they weighed for my price 30 pieces of silver. What's interesting is right in the middle of this weighing and this word silver is the word Aleph Tav. Again, a picture of the Messiah. My price, 30 pieces of silver. Amen? Ki tisa rosh b'nei Israel. So in three or four verses, we saw the gospel all over the place. Isn't that amazing? Hallelujah. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you sent your son Yeshua, that he was willing to come. Yeshua, we thank you that you laid down your life a ransom for many. We thank you that you were lifted up on the cross. We thank you that if we will lift you up, you will draw all men to yourself. Father, I ask that you will give us a hunger and a thirst for your word. Father, I ask that you will teach your people how to study. Father, I ask that you will give your people understanding of the Hebrew language. Father, I ask that as your people study the word, that they will be impressed by your Holy Spirit to dig into the text, to read it at surface value, but to also investigate the depths of your word. So teach us how to study. Teach us how to dig into your word. And illuminate Yeshua all through the Bible. May we see Yeshua in every word and phrase and every page. Bless your people today. Amen. Hallelujah.